Hello, Olivia. Hello. Thank you.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Yeah, and congratulations for Dartmouth class of 2028. So, first of all, yeah, I just want to know about your like journey and when your journey started.
So, my journey started when I was born, of course. I think the first time I started thinking about college applications as a whole, like in a mature manner, was right after my 10th boards finished. So I think that's when I actually started thinking about, okay, like, where do I want to go? What do I want to do? That's when I would say my thinking process started. But I feel like I actually started building on my application and my resume when in the start of 12th grade, almost, I would say. Yes.
Okay.
Which is very late, I must say. But I was able to figure it out and do it, yes.
Yeah, amazing. Grades. So can we start from the grades, like in 10th grade, 11th, how much you scored?
I gave the IGCSE in Dubai, and we had a different grading system. We had a grading system from 1 to 9. 9 being like a high A star and 8 being a low A star, high A. So I did not do the best in my 10th boards. I had 4 9s, 4 8s and 1 5. Like, it's not the best. It's not bad either. My subjects were mathematics, extended mathematics, history, sociology, biology, economics, French, and I think that's it.
Yeah, amazing. Amazing.
And English literature.
Literature. Okay, amazing.
And in IB in 11th grade. So my subjects are Math AAHL, Economics HL, and Psychology HL. SLs are French, ab initio, Biology SL, and English SL. So in 11th grade first term, 11th grade second term, 12th grade first term, I think I got all of them. I got 40 and 41, around that, out of 42.
42, yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, and Olivia, can you list down all your extracurriculars, just like our list and overview of your all extracurricular, because the list is extremely huge. So that's why, please give the overview.
So I'm just gonna open my activity list and then go according to that. I was the CEO and co-founder of Vakalat AI, which is a free legal AI chatbot built to ensure equitable access to legal information for all Indian citizens. We visited Shark Tank because of it. We won national awards by NGOs and by media. We were endorsed by the Indian government and also the G20 Sherpa. We were mentored and funded by Harvard University, and we were also beta. We were in collaboration and working on it with lawyers, NGOs, and legal aid centers. That's my biggest activity, Vakalat. Second activity, I was the music president of JPIS. I'm stage performer and lead vocalist of my band. It's called D2O. I've performed in many assemblies. I've coached juniors. I've worked on track arrangement. I do a lot of song covers on my Instagram, which is like a personal hobby that I like to do. I've also done like 2 to 3 live gigs with my band, and I've also entered into a few competitions, music singing wise. Then I'm a published author of my book, A Starting Point. It took me a long, long time to write it, but I'm a published author. I had around 300 in sales, held a few book launches. Yes, that is the third one. Now, when it comes to psychology and relating to my major, I got a 100% scholarship through Scholarly, a research paper program where I worked with a professor from Allegheny College about psychology, and I learned to research. I'm also in process of starting on working on independent research projects. One thing that I was working on is music effects brain and mood, and another thing that I was working on is how socioeconomic background of students affects the way they cope with stress. So that's something that I was working with. We won a national level competition called InPsych 22, and where we enacted a skit on bulimia, that's also psychology related. I'm the hostel cultural head girl of Jayashree Periwal International School. I chaired an MUN. I started a book sustainability platform. That's that. I also interned at the SMS Medical College in Jaipur under the Department of Psychiatry, and I was the youngest intern there. So I was able to shadow fellow doctors and stuff to see how they diagnose and treat patients. And I also got to observe how the ink blot test and the IQ test is done on patients. Additionally, I was the vice president of Habitat for Humanity, and we raised over around 5 lakh to 6 lakh rupees for homeless shelters across India. And we were also recognized in the global newsletter, and it was around 70 to 80 volunteers. So that was one project of mine as well. And I was also an actor and music mentor in JPIS's rendition of Hamilton. And it was also attended by the national actor, Johnny Lever. And I oversaw logistics, sound and performance. And I played the part of Miss Mariah Reynolds. So that is a little bit of what I do. So it's a combination of music, it's a combination of psychology and social service.
So you have like great extracurriculars and great profile. So according to you, which is the most strongest part of your college application, which is extracurriculars, your academics or tests like SAT, AP? So which is the most strongest part according to you?
Okay. I don't actually like to give importance to any specific part. I feel like my application just as a whole just fit in together, because obviously a common application or a college application, especially for the US, is something that you put together as a portrayal of who you are as a person. So neither my academics define me as a whole, or neither do my essays, or neither do my activities. So I genuinely feel like it was a combination of all of them together that just clicked and portrayed like one whole story and one whole individual picture of who I was.
Perfect. And what about SAT? Like, how did you score good marks and like preparation tips and anything?
So I was actually giving SAT at a very rough time when SAT was making the shift from paper and pencil to the digital SAT.
Yeah.
So that's a bit tough, of course, but now though people are going to be applying and not going to be facing that issue. But otherwise, I gave 3 attempts. My first attempt was a 1420. My second attempt, which was a digital SAT, was a 1390. And my third attempt, finally, was 1520. So I had that 120 point increase. And that was where I stopped. That was my raw score that I submitted to college. I feel like SAT practice is all about building your base. As much as people like to think, you know, you should be practicing papers and questions and bombarding yourself with all of that, that's only when you actually have your actual base figured out. Because SAT is all about, it's the fundamentals. As soon as you have your concept straight, you can build upon that through practice, paragraph. But if your initial thing is not strong enough, you cannot really move forward. So I feel like no matter how much you struggle with a topic, if let's say if you struggle with y equals mx plus c, so you make sure that you do all different types of that question to see where you're going wrong. Something that's very, very integral that people say, okay, do past papers, like, and keep doing them. But what you're supposed to do when you're actually doing those past papers is you're supposed to see what you're getting wrong, why you're getting that wrong, and then fix on improving that to, and then moving forward once you have that checkbox ticked off. Otherwise, there's no really point of you practicing these past papers if you're not trying to improve from them fundamentally. So I think that's the one thing about SAT that when I actually, you know, put my mind to it, I studied for 2 weeks, and it's actually like a kind of a fluke because I studied only for 2 weeks before my 1520 attempt, and I only studied maths, and I ended up getting my breakup was a 770 in math and a 750 in English. So that just happened. So I didn't even study for English during that time. So I feel like, again, it's just practice, and it's just for English especially, how much you read, how much you're good with reading, and I think that's very important. And obviously what you do in your daily class, whether it's readings for class or you're reading novels or you're doing just simple math practice in class, that also helps in the SAT. So there's no code to crack. And again, some people are not test takers. They do not do, like, they don't function well under certain conditions.
Yeah.
They don't function under timed conditions.
Time.
So it's not important, like, for you to have the best SAT score to get into a great college or with a scholarship. But I do believe that if your academics are very strong, even if you don't give the SAT and if you're not scoring well, it's okay because your academics show the colleges that you can do well academically. But for example, if your academics are a bit mediocre, which mine in some aspects, I did not have like A star. So that's why I feel like the SAT gave me a way to show them that yes, I also can bring my application up academically through the SAT. So although it is test optional, I do recommend every single person to try give the SAT because it is another application component that was required in the past. Give it 2 to 3 times. And if you're still not getting that upward, you know, incline, then you should focus on other parts of your application. It's not the most important, but if you can do it, it's great.
Yeah, amazing. And like there are many students, they are thinking that, okay, if I don't have a good academic, so I can manage by taking SAT and scoring good marks. So which is not true because you can't manage your academics by taking SAT. How you can explain yourself in one single word? Who is Olivia in just one line?
There's no way I can do that. There's no way I can do that.
Yeah,
that's so difficult.
Two lines.
Lines.
Yeah,
you
lines.
Said words.
No, words. It's like, yeah, impossible. But yeah, you can take one or two lines according to your comfort. Who is Olivia?
I think Olivia is a very strong girl that really likes to improve herself, that is always looking for something dynamic. I really like dynamicity.
Okay,
but I really like to be genuine. I really like to stay true to who I am. I always like to learn from other people. I love creating relationships with people that are long lasting. I love having a good time. I think that's it. Like,
okay, so yeah. Olivia is a strongest girl who like to be a dynamic, who love to make connections. And
I always like to improve and be better than who I was in the past. I think I don't like stagnancy at all. I don't like being at one point, or I don't like being the same person that I was maybe a month back, because I think then what's the point? I'm not learning, I'm not growing, I'm not improving. And I think I think that genuity is very, very important. I love to stay true to who I am, no matter what people may say, or, you know, no matter what the standards of society may be. I really like to make sure that I am portraying who I am. And then the people that like me, they like me. And if they don't like me, that's fine. But through that mentality, I've had really great relationships in my life. And if you don't do stuff for yourself, then who are you actually doing stuff for others? At the end of the day, it's a short life. You're going to eventually not live anymore. Most of what it is, and I think that's the way it should be, and that's very integral to the college application process, because you need to exactly show who you are. Even if you may not have the best idea of who you are, if you portray who you are, it's gonna be unique. And if you try to portray something that you're not, it's gonna show.
Like, what's about your story or journey? Like, every student have their unique journey, unique story. Any story you thought that, okay, it's my story?
Yes, I have a story, and it is also actually my Common App essay.
Yeah,
but I'll tell you my story. I'll tell you about my essay. So like I told you, I started thinking about the college application process in 10th grade, at the end of 10th grade. So I used to be in Dubai for around 14 years of my life. So until 10th grade, I was studying in Dubai, and I just came to India in the start of 11th grade to get a better education. So in Dubai, my parents have basically been going through really, really bad. So we've always had family conflicts in our life. My parents don't exactly get along very well. And that actually inhibited my growth in a lot of ways. I was not allowed to, you know, like explore myself socially, or like even academically, or in an extracurricular manner when I was back at home in Dubai in 8th grade, 7th grade, 9th grade, 10th grade. So that really stopped me from a lot of what I did. And eventually, when things got worse between them and they were not really able to focus on us, I kind of went off track. I wouldn't say I went off track, but I don't know if I'm allowed to say this or not, but I started to party a lot. I exploded in a manner, you know? So I started partying, I started going out. And this was all in the start of 9th grade when I was supposed to be focusing on my boards. I gave the IGCSE curriculum. So at the start of 9th grade, I thought to myself, oh my God, yeah, I'm going to get all A stars. But then my family broke apart. My dad moved out of our house. And because of like that split, I found that gap. Like, my dad used to keep me very disciplined. So when he left the house, I was like, oh, now I can do whatever I want. Like, I want to explore everything. And so I did that and I started partying. Oh. And although I'm not really proud of this, but it is what it, I want to be true. Like, I'm not sure, again, if I'm allowed to say this or not, but I want to tell my story in the way that actually is.
Yeah.
I started doing all of these things. And, I used to go out till 4 a.m. I used to go out to people didn't even know. And although that helped me so much socially, and I really know how to, like, go out and make friends, and that's really made me very social, I kind of lost track of who I wanted to be. As a little girl, I wanted to go to Harvard on a scholarship. I wanted to go to US. So, yes, it was in my mind. But then when I... by the end of 10th grade, when I've done all of this, my health deteriorated.
Okay.
I was addicted at one point as well. So when I saw that shift, like start of 9th grade, oh my God, I want to get all A stars. End of 10th grade, I'm like, who am I? Like, what happened to that dream? And that is why I made the decision to move to India.
Yeah.
And although, like, it was a 5-day decision, me moving to India, like, I just told my dad, Papa, like, I'm not happy with, you know, the way my life is right now. And I told him, I want to go to a better school. And he's like, okay, either you stay in the school that you are, or you go to India, into a boarding school in India. And although that making that decision was so difficult for me, I don't even remember saying yes to that, because it's such a huge thing. Imagine you've set your whole life in one country for 14 years.
Yeah.
And it's like, all of a sudden, you have this, like, I had this urge, I'm like, jana hai, like, I want to make something of my life. My mom is struggling financially, my parents are all over the place, I have a little sister who's 12 years old. If I don't make a life for myself, if I don't build up on that dream that I had for myself as a kid, then what am I doing?
Yeah.
It was a 5-day decision. I told my dad first day, Papa, I want to go. Second day, he's like, okay, which school? And I knew about this current school I am, JPIS. I knew about it before, and it's from, I'm Rajasthani, and this is Rajasthan as well.
Yeah.
The second day, he's like, okay, this school. Third day, I give the admissions test. Next day, we waited for the response. Fifth day, I got my acceptance from JPIS. 6th, 7th day, shopping. And then 8th day, flight.
Oh.
And it was that quick.
Yeah.
And I didn't think I was able to process what happened. It was just very, very bad. But coming here, oh my God, I could just, like, this is who I am. I'm here, like, because of that risk that I took. So I would encourage everybody watching that if you ever feel stagnant, or if you ever feel like you need to improve on something, you have to take that big leap of faith. You have to take that risk in order for you to get somewhere. It was not easy in the slightest. I left behind my cat, my mom, my dad. My cat isn't even alive anymore, almost, kind of. So, but you have to sacrifice something to get somewhere. And I feel like the sacrifice was worth it.
Yeah, I think the whole story is amazing. Like, 8 days changed your life. And yeah, it was like hardest decision of your life. And I think best decision of your life, hardest and best. So, like, now you are Olivia. Okay, you write it down, this story, in your essays or something else.
Yes, so I can tell you about my Common App essay, which in my opinion was one of, like, the best things I've ever wrote.
Okay.
Not the best, but the most vulnerable thing that I've ever written.
Yeah.
So my Common App essay was basically about how I moved, and how me moving meant that I was leaving behind my mother, who was in a very, very bad place financially, because my parents were separated, and they just entered into the, like, legal battles and divorce. And seeing my mom struggle with that, so she was unable to get lawyers, she was unable to get legal help in the way, she was homeless at a point. And, you know, there was a lot of conflicts going on back at home. So I grew up with that. I grew up with these legal battles, and I grew up with these legal conflicts that my family was going through, especially my mother, who did not have a job, so she was not able to handle herself financially. So because of that, I created my biggest project, the biggest activity on my list. It's called Vakalat AI. I think you also interviewed Aditya Singh.
I know everything about Vakalat AI and Aditya. Yeah.
So me and Aditya are co-founders. I came up with the idea because of my personal conflicts, and he helped me with everything else from that journey, the entire process of creating the project. But Vakalat AI is one of my strongest ECs. We went to Harvard MUN, and we won Impact Initiative there. And we were funded. So we're funded by Harvard now, and we're also mentored by them. So that's
last week. Yeah, I think. You received last week.
Quite a lot of awards and recognition for it. But I think I would like to say to everybody out there that, again, this project is something I did because of who I was. It came from a personal family conflict that affected me so much. Like, you wouldn't even imagine. Like, I couldn't do a lot of things because of my family conflicts. Because of their conflicts, I couldn't go out for competitions. I couldn't go out of hostel because of custody issues. And
yeah.
There's so much. And my dad's not from a very, very rich family. We don't come from like a really good place of financial support compared to all of my other peers in my school. My other peers are from very affluent families, but I come from a middle-class family. My dad does not own a business. He does a job. And that's very, I'm not trying to speak from a privileged point of view because I know how much I have.
Yeah.
But in comparison to all of my peers that are here,
yeah.
I consider myself disadvantaged because their parents can afford $6,000 research program,
yeah.
summer abroad program. And when I asked my dad, he's like, beta, I have nothing to give you. I can't do this. And I felt that was unfair to me. I was like, oh, like, how am I going to get into college? If all my peers are doing Pioneer, Horizon, they're doing GHU my study abroad programs and they're going to Columbia and Brown. So then I can't do any of that. So, and plus, I was in the hostel. I can't even go outside. And even if I tried to go outside, the custody and the legal battles would all come in. And it was just so, so tough, even the process here. But I found a way through that, you know? I found a way through that. If I would like to tell a small story, I think I wrote about it in some of my essays, not my Dartmouth essays. But again, like I told you, I am into research. I'm a psychology major, a cognitive science major. And while I was in school, I wanted to explore psychology in an extracurricular manner. And all my peers could do these expensive research programs, $6,000, $2,500. And I just couldn't. Like, I even tried to ask my dad. I didn't even ask my dad because I knew that it was a no. So there's no way that I would even go for it. So I thought that was it. I thought, oh, I can't do research now because I can't do research programs. I'm a high school student. I don't know how to do research. But then I asked some of my seniors, I'm like, is there any way I can do research without having to pay for it? Or like, how do I start? I didn't know where to start. I asked my professors, I asked my teachers in school. Nothing really worked. So one of my seniors recommended that I should cold email. And I never knew what cold emailing was. It was like a foreign concept to me. So when I was used to the concept, I was like, okay. I was so dedicated that in one night I emailed around 60 to 70 professors.
Amazing.
From every single university, not every single. I think I took Oak Jindal, Ashoka, some IITs also, I think I took. I went to psychology professors and cognitive science professors from those universities, emailed them that, hi, my name is Olivia. I'm a psychology student. I would love to do research. 6 to 7 got back to me. And I started even working with one of them at the end of it. And that one professor from OP Jindal, Dr. Landquist, I think that's what his name is, he referred me to this program called Scholarly. And I managed to get 100% scholarship from Scholarly to do research. So that's one of the parts of my application as well about the research and how I got a scholarship to do it. But what I'm trying to show is that although I couldn't do what my friends could, my lack of resources pushed me into doing, like working times harder to get what they did in the same way. And although it's unfair and although it may take 10 times more effort, it made me a stronger person. I now know how to cold mail. I now know how to network. I reached out to those 7 to 8 professors that got back to me. Now I have relations with them. And, you know, I got a scholarship for what they did.
Yeah.
They paid $2,000 for it. I did it for zero. So that journey of like getting there without resources, without support, without connections in a foreign country and stuff, that taught me so much. So I would just like to say to everyone out there who thinks that they are disadvantaged, that your journey is going to be difficult. It does mean that you'll have to take 5 to 10 extra steps to get where you are. But I feel like running the extra mile makes you stronger than maybe those who are at a more advantaged position. So I would just like to say, if there's any way that you're facing problems or setbacks or any resources that you don't have, then there's always, always a way around it. And you can always, always figure it out. anything is possible. That's what I believe, because I think my story is all about the fact that anything is possible and you are capable. And that was my Common App essay as well. I thought as a kid that, you know, I wasn't capable enough because of my family issues and I wouldn't get anywhere. But then when my mom struggled with these financial issues and when I made Vakalat AI, it was a way to help her. And I finally got rid of that. It's not that I'm not helpless. That was the main word I said that I used. I'm not helpless. Okay. I am strong and I am a fighter and I can do whatever I want. And so one of my lines I'm quoting from the essay is, I did not only help empower my mom, but also like thousands across India who would come to use my service for legal help. So I think that my journey is inspiring in the way that you should take from that. Everything is possible no matter where you come from, no matter what you have. And I think that's the beauty of the US college application process, because it's not that they don't care, but they take into context that you don't have these resources. And if you show that, no, despite not having these resources, I can make so much of myself and I can do so much with my life and with my academics and my extracurriculars, this is what I bring to the table without having. So imagine if I had at your college what I would be able to do.
Yeah.
And that is what you showcase, that potential, and that comes across if you're genuine.
You proved that God have plans for everyone. And and your journey is not just a journey of experience, it's a journey of experiences, because your extracurriculars not reflecting a profile building, it's reflecting your like journey and your like personal profile. So I think it's that's the beauty of your extracurriculars. And I already love Vakalat AI. And what about your other friends? They got into some good universities. So according to you, any student who you thought that, okay, that's the student who is the most deserving and best student?
We just have early rounds done, right?
Yeah.
So many of my amazingly talented friends have not been accepted yet. And they have applied to universities and they will get into great universities. But I think till now, if I'm talking about just till this date, one of my friends, Urja, she just got into U Chicago on
amazing.
3 point something crore scholarship, merit-based and need-based. And I think she's very, very hardworking.
Right.
I think, again, we don't have that many acceptances yet, but I think Uja, Vora, we both took the journey together. We are both financial aid applicants. It's really tough for both of us. She did not have ECs. I did not have ECs. Like, my application was zero when I came here. I built it in a matter of six months. Exactly. Without resources, that's what I'm saying. And she as well, again, we were in the same boat, and she's also a hostler with me. So we really went through some of that process together, and I'm so, so proud of her. And I see the hard work that she puts in. She's very strong academically. She's like the smartest person I know academically.
Amazing.
And she's a 45 IB student person.
Yeah.
She's although I think extracurriculars were not her strongest suit, internally, she's a very academically driven person. The way she was able to build her extracurricular profile and get her 3 point something scholarship from U Chicago, need aware school, it's just amazing. So if I would talk about one person, it would be her.
Yeah. And what about AP exams?
So we have great counselors here at school. And since I'm an IB student, we already have so much workload. Our counselors never recommended AP exams to us.
Yeah.
So I just did not think that I wanted to give any. And
it's not
academics.
Necessary.
And plus, again, I did not have any awards. I did not have any activities when I came here. So if I had something, I would. But I wanted to focus more on that. And my academics, so it's fine. I think if you're an ICSE, I think if you're in CBSE, then you should do it.
Yeah.
It shows that you can do the American nature of learning, American style of learning. But since we are IBs in an international curriculum, plus SAT bhi tha mere paas, I didn't think that the exams.
And Olivia, what about like university list? How many universities you applied for and in how many you got into?
I thought that I wouldn't get in anywhere. I literally had a 50 university list. Before, just in the early round, I think I applied to 25 universities. Besides Dartmouth, I applied to 25 universities. And for some of them, I paid the application fee, because you know how Common App has a limit of
20. Money. Yeah.
Do you know Square?
Yeah, Coalition. Now, name is Square.
Exactly. So you can do unlimited there. So I did all of them from there. So I didn't reduce my Common App spots. And for some of them, I had to pay an application fee. I sent my CSS profile to all of those colleges. So itna, like, I think my application, like, fee ka pura, like, total amount was, like, so much. But I actually thought I wouldn't get in anywhere. And turns out I got into my ED. So it was really funny. And my dad's like, wow, beta, like,
yeah,
it's okay. Like, no problem. You got in. On like, it's fine. But thoda trust in yourself.
Yeah.
So I think, yeah. Again, I withdrew my application like from all colleges now though. So I can't say that I got accepted in anywhere else. I did apply to like Vanderbilt and in the early round, I wanted to apply to all these companies as well, but now though, Dartmouth. So I'm not very informed on what you do, but there's a group on WhatsApp that I was in for like a really long time. Financial aid students from all across the world who, you know, used to discuss colleges and application components.
Yeah.
And over there, I met Mr. Sanjay Soni. And we discussed a lot about college and, you know, on private chat. So, and then he told me about Cross the Sky Limits. And then
yeah,
he's like, okay, would you like to do an interview for us? And I actually saw your videos before. So when I first was researching to Dartmouth, and I was like, okay, should I make this my ED college? I came across one interview that you did of Jayesh Chaudhary.
Yeah.
2027, and I remember looking at that interview and getting very inspired by him and, you know, the all the things he did.
Yeah.
So he has an activity, an extracurricular called Kalpurze.
Yeah,
and very, very close to what I had with Vakalat.
Yeah.
So what he did with Kalpurze, I had so many ideas because of that. So, and also I was like, oh, you know, he also didn't start his application very early.
Yeah.
Neither did I.
Yeah.
And he was also from a CBSE school. And I also did not know anything about college apps.
Yeah.
I wasn't preparing my entire life for college apps. So that really inspired me. And that was, so as soon as I saw that, okay, you were the one who's actually going to conduct this interview, I was like, I have to. Because if I was inspired by an interview that you did, then I'm sure that there must be someone out there, someone
yeah,
out there who will be inspired by the interview that I'm currently doing.
Yeah.
And so I do thank you for the, like, because for people, like, again, it's a very difficult process to
yeah,
actually
exactly
understand. It's months and months of work and preparation, thinking and executing. It's so difficult. So I feel like if I can hear a story of a student who's gotten in, and if I can understand what the application looked like, it will give me more of an idea of what I want to do. And that's what you made possible for me through your interview with Jayesh at who gone to Dartmouth. So thank you for that.
Thank you. And I think next year there will be another student who is talking about Olivia because
oh my god,
yeah, Olivia is
I hope
me. Yeah,
I hope,
yeah, because
yeah,
yeah, because your profile is really amazing. And what about your financial aid, like how much financial aid?
Oh, I got around $70,000 per year.
Okay, so like it's cover full or like part?
Yes. No, so basically, again, Dartmouth is need-based. So all the financial aid you get and the scholarship you get is need-based. So my
yeah,
family submitted documents of my dad's income, our assets, the trust that I have, the funds that we have. And through that, they created an
yeah,
application. Okay, how much can my family afford?
Yeah.
And the final amount is something that my family can afford. So obviously, very grateful to Dartmouth. But I think the financial aid committee is very flexible. So if you go there and if there's any sort of discrepancy or if something happens, they will definitely accommodate it.
Yeah.
So to anybody like out there who wants to apply for financial aid, who needs scholarships, I think that need-blind colleges, number one, like Dartmouth, should be your best
yeah,
shot, because it's not a disadvantage to you that you cannot pay $90,000 a year. That's crazy. Like my dad told me that no, like there's no way that I can afford or even try to afford $90,000 per year plus visa fee plus that will come to around 100,000, which is like huge amounts. Balki, you can do the same thing for a few lakhs in India, right? The same like degree.
Yeah.
But obviously for us, like who want that exposure, the going abroad exposure, going to a top 20 college and stuff like that, I think anybody can get a scholarship if they're good enough. If they like you, they will take you regardless of, you know, the amount of aid that you
aid,
need.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
I used to think, oh my God, like, I need aid. I'll never make it to college. That's
yeah,
why I applied to 50. Because I was like, and not only US, I was going to apply to UK.
Okay.
I was going to apply to
Canada.
I was going to apply to Singapore. I was going to apply to Amsterdam, Canada. I already sent my Canada applications
yeah,
to Toronto, UK. Also, I genuinely thought I couldn't get in anywhere. I was like, end mein jana hai to Ashoka jana hai ya Kriya jana. you know, but
okay.
anything is possible. And
yeah.
I can't believe that I'm sitting here and telling you that, oh my God, I'm going to the US in like 7 months.
Yeah.
Or like almost everything funded. So it's possible and you can do it.
Yeah, and like a same line I used in Jayesh video, which is college application have the system of key and lock system or best fit. So I think, yeah, like they find out best fit for their college.
So I was a bit unsure about Dartmouth because of its rural setting.
Yeah,
and
rural.
Because
yeah.
it's smaller. And I was like, But
yeah.
my first of all, I got in touch with Jayesh, who told me so much about the place and he made me just fall in love with it.
Yeah.
And then also my sister recommended it to me because the amount of aid I needed, need blind was the best way to go.
Yeah.
And I think my counselor in some aspect saw some sort of fit.
Yeah, there is
me.
Yeah.
And one thing that we should really keep in mind about the college application process is writing the essays. For example, you were talking about fit, I'm talking about fit. Although you should be yourself, you should be keeping in mind what the college values. For example, I know that Dartmouth has this People, Places, Pines. That's its like, that's its blog name. I made sure that the essays I wrote really fit its values. For example, Dartmouth is looking for somebody who has unique perspective. And so all that I told you on this call with my family, with my moving across countries, especially with Vakalat, the things that I was able to do because of my family issues. And I think that I was able to portray a really, really nice, unique story.
Yeah.
And it was not just a story, it was a personal experience.
Yeah.
So very genuine. And across all my essays, I made sure that whatever I was writing, one of my essays was introduce yourself, be yourself, introduce who you are.
Yeah.
And I have a very unique essay, if I can tell you, about like just the things I carry with me. For example, I wrote about my glasses. I took them off. I'll put them on. But
yeah.
I wrote about my glasses. So who am I? So you even asked me who I am. I don't know. I can't tell you in two seconds who I am. But what I can do is I can show you the objects around me and I can give you a description of who I am. For example, my glasses, I wrote in my essay about how before I didn't wear them and now and my eyesight, because I thought that I would be judged for wearing my glasses. I thought that, oh, I would look ugly or like, oh, like I look nerdy. So I didn't wear it. So because of that, my eye power really like went down.
Oh.
So because of that, I realized that just to see others, like, you know, just to make sure I please others, I couldn't be destroying my vision. So now I wear my glasses a lot.
Yeah,
that's who I am. I have a lot of braces in my hand. Itna tha, abhi maine, I just took a shower, so I took them off. But I have so many braces in my hand from people that I love and my friends. So I keep them with me. So I wrote in my essay about who I was. I was like, I have like around 15 to 20 bracelets in my hand.
Amazing.
That shows who I am because each bracelet is like
representing something. Yeah.
Representing who I am. One of my friends that have taught me something great in life, and my mom, my dad, my sister. So I keep a collection of that. And I wrote about my lunchbox, about how like I bring food in it to bring to give to people, give to my friends.
Yeah,
exactly. So that I can form better relationships with them, and that's who I am. So stuff like that. So do you see how unique it is? And it does not have to be this unique, you know, it does not have to be like this. It just felt right to me to write about that.
Yeah.
And I think that's very, very important, the process, because you may think that you need to write about you, because then if you listen to somebody else and if you take somebody else's word for it, and then it's just going to come across as not true. And you'd rather you get in being yourself.
And what about your future plans? Like any future plans? You chose psychology as your major. So any future plans, any inspiration? Okay, I want to become like that person. Any something like that?
I think I'm just 17. I have so much to explore.
Yeah,
even though
I
think psychology and cognitive science is a very academic interest for me. Like, I don't know how much of a career I want to pursue it. Like, I don't know if I want to become a therapist. I think I would like to become a researcher. I love to research.
Yeah.
I love to learn about people, why they behave the way they behave.
Yeah.
So that's why I chose psychology as my major. I would love to explore economics. I would love to explore public policy.
Mm-hmm.
And because of Vakalat, and because I'm so interested in legal studies, fields like criminology as well. And I'm so into music as well. So I wanted to kind of take that as a minor too. So I'm interested in so many things. And I feel like that's the beauty of a liberal arts college. It will allow me to do that. Whatever classes I want, I'm free to explore whatever I want.
Yep.
So I think right now, all I know is that I want to do something that will make me happy, that will keep me stimulated, that will allow me to meet people and keep growing and making connections and exposure. I want a career that's dynamic, like I told you. So I still want to explore so much. And yeah.
And Olivia, any advice for all students, like for college application, not for college application, for their like academics, for their personal life, any advice you want to give them?
So I wrote a list. It's here. I'm just gonna off the top of my head. So this is not that much. Okay.
Yeah.
First of all, do what you think is right. There's no correct formula. Even if you have counselors that will advise you, listen to them, take into consideration their perspective. But at the end of the day, it's your application. If you don't get in, and if you did something that somebody else told you to do, you'll be like, shit, what if I could have just been myself? And what if I could have gotten who I was?
Yeah.
I had so many conflicts with the people who were guiding my application about what to write about. And although I took into account their consideration, I was stubborn that I wanted to keep my individuality. I was stubborn that I wanted to be who I was, even if that did not mean that I was the strongest application. Like, if I did not know something, if I did not know what I wanted to do, I made sure I wouldn't make something up randomly. So do what you think, right? Because at the end of the day, colleges don't want a perfect person. You know, they don't expect. They know you're a kid. So if you can,
high school student.
Exactly. So be who you are. Don't try to be something you're not. That's the first advice.
Yeah.
Second advice that it's all over. It's not a chronological order, but second advice that your college application is all about execution. It's not about. So, for example, I'm actually taking this advice from somebody else's video that I saw, but it's all about the way you present yourself. Like, I could be like, oh, you know, I sing, so I'm a singer. I used to do a lot of music. I even submitted music supplements to Dartmouth. And I could just say that, oh yeah, I sing in my school sometimes and da da da. But the way I wrote it in my application was, you know, head of music club, performed in front of 800 audience members. Beautiful. And you know, created a band in school, winning 2 competitions. So it's all about the way you execute. Like, it's all a bit about the way you write about yourself. It's like, like, can you imagine, I took me wearing my glasses and my bad eyesight, and I created it into a way to say that, oh, I don't want to be judged by people anymore. I want to stay true to myself, wear my glasses. So that's the way you write about something. That's how you do your common app. It's the way you execute who you are.
Good one.
Third is for all the people who are very, very anxious, or for all the people who want to start early, make a, you know, common app account. Start early. Start thinking about, you know, what you're going to do. I don't encourage at all that you write essays 1 year before college apps. No. Start writing your essays 4 to 5 months before, you know, the deadline is coming. But make a common app account. See, like, okay, you have 10 activities. In 10 activities, like, start thinking ahead. Like, what do I want my 10 activities to look like? Or, like, I think that really will start getting you thinking that, okay, I'm entering into this phase of the college application process. Let me start curating who I am. Because you can do 10 different activities. You can do 20 different things. You can be MU and you can do arts. You can do singing. You can do academics, research papers. You can do 10, like, so many things. But at the end of the day, you only have 10 spots in your activities. Additional information that colleges may not even see. So you need to start thinking about what is most important to you, what you should cultivate. It's all about quality and not quantity. 2 days ago, I was talking to a student who came to me for advice, and she had so many activities. She had like 30 things just listed down.
Oh my God.
And the only thing I told her is that you having this many, it's great. You're so talented. So talented. But you have only 10 spots. So now it's time for you to cultivate. If you're a good debater, go to national camp. Start debating nationally. If you're a good singer, start giving Trinity exams. Yeah. Go up to grade 8. Go up to the highest level and give those exams. That's going to show that you're good at it. And not just you can do it, but that I'm good at it. If you like research, don't just write research papers and let it sit there. Go to journals. Like, get your research paper published. Work with a professor from a university. Go to a university and work in a lab. So build expertise on that one activity. For example, Vakalat. I could have just created Vakalat and let it sit there. But what I did is I entered Vakalat into 2 to 3 different competitions. I make sure I got credibility. I got recognition and awards for it. And that's what made my activity stand out. If I'm a singer in school, I'm not just going to do one performance and sit there. I'm going to go to two competitions, try to win them. I'm going to create a band. I'm going to create my own songs. I'm going to, you know, try to become music head of my school, which I did become. So it's all about that quality and what you can build up. That
yeah.
It's not that I can do it. I can do many things and I'm also good at them. Fourth one, again, genuity and being you. You have to do, okay, this is a line that I wrote like a while back.
Yeah.
You got to be you. You should do stuff that aligns with your interests in a competitive manner. That's exactly what I was explaining to you before.
Yeah.
Do what you like, but make sure that you're so damn good at it that nobody else can be better than you.
Yeah.
You know, it's not about what you do. There's no perfect extracurricular. There's no,
yeah.
Oh, this will get me to college. Nahi. Even Vakalat may not have gotten me into college.
Yeah.
But I did it because it was me. I did it because it was personally connected to me. And I played to my strength. I made it strong. And that's why, that's what it was. So again, there's no set formula that if I do this, I'm going to get into college. No. What do I like to do? I'm going to do that. I'm going to be good at it. And that's how I'm going to get into college.
Yeah, exactly.
Number five. It's just one line I'm going to say. Colleges don't want a well-rounded, like not don't want, but what colleges want
yeah.
are a well-rounded class. They don't want, like they're not looking for a well-rounded student. Although you can do you can do 10 things, but if you're so good at that one thing, it's going to make you stand out. That's what they call a spike in college applications, right? They call that a spike. So I think in my application, what I did is I made three spikes for myself. I couldn't choose one. I couldn't.
Yeah.
But I made three spikes for myself. One was social service. I put myself in a lot of volunteer projects. Vakalatya was also volunteer thing, social service projects. Second was psychology. So I did a lot of research and I won a lot of psychology competitions and essays and essay competitions and stuff. And third was music. I love music and music is such an integral part of my life. So these are the three spikes that I portrayed in my application. And my activity list is also curated in this manner. It's just social service, psychology, music.
Yes.
Sixth one, essay writing is so integral. It gives you a way to tell your story. So I feel like you should, the way you have great writing skills and you don't depend on AI and ChatGPT to write your essays is start reading. Like if you're starting earlier, on your college application, you want to prepare for it, then you start reading. The way you start reading and writing, it will really allow you to develop a good sense of vocabulary and it will really show you how to like write and language and everything. So that will really, really help you so much.
Yeah.
Some of the best. So Aditya got a really, really great SAT score. He had a 1550. And his vocabulary is one of the best that I know. Like he has amazing vocabulary because as a kid, he used to like read so much and he watches so many TV shows in like, you know, in English that leads to some knowledge of like language. And he's one of the best writers and best vocabulary that I've seen. So that is one really good proof. And I'm a writer. I'm an author as well. I've written a book, a small book. And I used to read so much back in primary school. I stopped reading. I want to get back into it.
Yeah.
But reading is so important because it helps you convey your thoughts when you read other people conveying their thoughts.
Yeah.
And last advice. Okay, that was a lot. Last advice, anything is possible. I did not think I would be here today telling you my story, and I did not think that I would be here and saying that, oh wow, I'm going to the US on a scholarship. And it was, again, I just did not think this. Anything is possible if you work hard enough. I was obsessed for 6 months. I was like, college applications. I literally myself from everybody.
Yeah.
I made it my life goal and I worked so hard towards it and I got it. And if you have that passion and rigor within you, there's no way ki nahi hoga. There's no way.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's the advice.
Okay, so there are seven advice, right? Okay.
Yes.
And I also want to advise to all students to start reading, because I also have reading habits. But every day before sleeping, just 1 hour. 1 hour or 1.5 hour is totally fine and enough. And second is like, I will put the link of Olivia's book. A few days ago, I just saw your story. So I just thought, okay, just purchase that book and start reading before the interview. But due to many stuff. So I strongly suggest to all students, just read that book. I will put the link. And your all points like quality over quantity and be yourself and focus on only few things, not the like thousands of extracurriculars, not thousands, hundreds of extracurriculars. So thank you. Yeah, thank you for sharing everything. I recommend to all students, just watch this interview and note down everything. because you're all points, and these looks like you can say that simple, but if you are applying in your application, so you will find something magical, or you can say that different in your profile. So I strongly suggest to all students, just write down everything about your profile, and if you are comfortable, then we can also share your essays. In our college application, there is also option to submit your music portfolio and art portfolio. So I think you also submitted. So please, can you explain about that?
Yes. So I've been a singer ever since I was a kid. Never been trained professionally, but I do it a lot recreationally. And yeah. I'm the head of music in my school, yeah. and I'm a very, very frequent performer. I love singing. It's one of my personal hobbies, as well as like a public connection, connective activity as well.
Yeah.
So that's why I felt I wanted to showcase what I can do singing wise and performance wise to all the colleges I was applying to. So Dartmouth gives you an option, and any Ivy League and any college as well gives you an option to submit a music portfolio or an arts portfolio. And I submitted 3 to 4 music supplements of my performances in school, and I even created 1 to 2 covers especially for the music supplement. So I got a question from one student who was also looking into submitting music supplements, that should I submit a music supplement, am I good enough? I wasn't professionally trained. I've never gone professional music classes. I don't do that. As much as I would love to do that, I'm not professional or technically very strong. So I really thought to myself, I'm like, what if I submit my music supplement video? If I'm not good enough, because those music supplements are not reviewed, not often reviewed by admissions committee. It's reviewed by the music faculty at the college.
Yeah.
So I was like, what if I'm not good enough? What if I'm not trained? What if it is a disadvantage to my application rather than an advantage? So it was a long thought process for me. I was like, I asked my music teachers, I'm like, do you think I should? They're like, yeah, I think you should. Yeah. Because, they thought I was good enough. I had some confidence in my thing. I really submitted music videos that I loved, that I loved myself in, that showed my performance abilities as well as my musical singing abilities. So I think you should be submitting something, because if you don't submit, you'll just be like any other applicant who did not submit. But if you do submit, it'll give colleges another way to assess you on who you are. And it's okay if you're not that good. Like I told you, me myself, I'm not that great. I can sing decently, and it's a passion, it's a side hobby. So I submitted because it felt right to me, and it wouldn't have felt right if I did not submit. So I was like, this is a part of me, and I should be showing colleges that. So I submitted my music supplements to Dartmouth. And I think you should submit it. Because it's a part of who you are, regardless of your expertise. And the fact that you even have this additional ability and this talent is a huge, huge thing. So, yeah.
Yeah. And I also suggest to all students to submit art portfolio, because it gives you something extra. You can say that extra part of your profile. Because I think only 3 to 4%, I think not 3 to, less than 1% students submitting their art portfolio or something like
that.
Yeah. So,
I don't know.
Yeah,
1 or 2 of my friends even submitted their paintings. They're not a painter, but they just submitted it because they want to show colleges that I also do this.
Also do that.
You know, why not? Because art is something so beautiful, and you cannot show that through a writing thing.
Yeah.
If you're good at it, that's also an art in itself.
Yeah.
But if you're good at painting, if you're good at singing, dancing, I really encourage you to submit. I really encourage you to submit it. Yeah.
But in India, I think the rate is quite low. But I think in USA and other countries, it's quite high. But in India, less than 3 to 4%. Yeah.
Exactly. It'll give you a way to even stand out of the box. So many people can sing well, dance well. So many people can do this, but they just need to, thoda acknowledge it and showcase it. I think it's very important.
Yeah.
I think music was one of my really, really strong parts of my application. I even submitted a music resume that showcased all the performances I've done.
Nice.
So that was really strong as well, my application. I think that was one of the strongest parts about my application.
Yeah.
So definitely. Yeah.
Yeah. So amazing profile. Everything is perfect. And thank you, Olivia, for sharing your invaluable thoughts and experience with our whole community. And in future, we will also take interview after 1 or 2 years, because I think you are constantly improving and just focusing on your future goals. And so thank you. Congratulations for Dartmouth. Yeah, congratulations. And it's not my words, it's like whole CDS. Like there are many students who will message me personally after this interview for congratulations. So congratulations again. And it's a starting of your journey, I think. Because
it is.
Yeah, because college life is, you can say that, next level of life. You can say that a major or most important part of your life.
I've never been to the US. It's going to be my first time. I'm so scared. And where Dartmouth is located, it gets so cold and it's snowing.
Yeah.
Bro, happy Jaipur mein, it's so cold.
Yeah.
It's like -7 degrees and I can't do it because I'm from Dubai, right? So it's very hot there. 7 degrees in India, okay. It's bad. But imagine -15 degrees
at
Dartmouth. I'm scared. But yeah. Thank you so much for having me. I loved to be able to tell my story.
Yeah.
Although I have so much more to say.
Yeah.
I think
infinite.
Now this is enough.
Yeah, and I think like it's about adaptation. So you will adapt everything in just 3 to 4 months in USA. So it's all about adaptation. And if any student have any kind of questions, doubts, and want to get your help, so how they can contact you? Like, are you active on LinkedIn or any other social media?
So I'm sure, Krishna, you can give a link to my LinkedIn. I put most of my, everything is on there. But I think if anybody wants to contact me, I'm not that active on LinkedIn. I check it once in a while. But I think you can definitely text me on Instagram. My Instagram also, he will link down there. But that's where I'm most active. I can also give my email. And I think, email. But LinkedIn works. I'll keep checking it every now and then.
Yeah, so just go and follow Olivia on LinkedIn and all social media accounts. So thank you, Olivia, for joining us. And thank you for joining Cross the Sky Limit. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Let's cross the sky limits.
Okay. Thank you, Olivia. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.